Sometimes it takes seven times around. Sometimes it takes too many to count. Sometimes you wanna give up, but keep marching, keep marching, keep marching till you hear the ground shake. Keep marching, today could be the day. Keep marching, God is gonna make a way.
Yes, he can. Oh, did he defeat Well, if you're glad to be in church, somebody say amen. Let's stand all over the building, shake somebody's hand, tell them it's good to see them in church on a Sunday night. Amen. Welcome to church tonight. Good to see you. Ain't you glad you're in the house of the Lord tonight? Boy, what a good time we had in the Lord this morning. I appreciate His presence. I'm looking forward to what God's going to do for us this evening. And let me make a few announcements real quickly, then we'll get right on into the service. Don't forget, April the 1st, I hope you got your calendars marked. April the 1st will be our big day here on the grounds with our spring festival. And looking forward to a big crowd, a big outpouring from the community. We're going to pour our love and show Jesus a little while out there in the field to our community. And if you have not signed up to be a volunteer, please do that in the foyer this evening as soon as you can. And then also don't forget, right around the corner is Resurrection Sunday. Somebody say amen. Amen. We rejoice every Sunday, the first day of the week that Jesus is alive. Amen. But on that particular weekend, we're going to have a great weekend here on Saturday night, April the 8th at, I don't forget what time it is, 6 o'clock. We're going to have a worship service here and then have a good time in the Lord. And then on Sunday morning at 11 o'clock, we're going to celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I need you to get all those invite tracks back there. And they've been going like hotcakes. We appreciate all the invites you're doing. But let's not let up. Let's not let up. We are praying and asking God to pack this sanctuary full of people who has never met the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ. So I want you to do your part by passing them out, giving out invites. I've already been working on my end, talking to the Lord and praying and asking God to give me the exact words to say and preach in power and demonstration of His Spirit. And then we're going to let Lord do the rest of the work. Amen. So you do yours, I'll do mine, and we know God will do His. And let's make plans to have a good time in the Lord. Also, May the 6th, we've been mentioning this every service. May the 6th is something we've never done here before. And that is, we're trying to bridge the gap between parents and children. So if you've got a child living in your household, it don't matter if it's your biological or not, or your grandchild, it don't matter. If you got a kid that's living in your house, I want you to make plans May the 6th to be here that day, and we'll have a good time in the Lord. We're going to have breakout sessions. We're going to have some preaching. We're going to have some singing. We'll be doing some praying. We'll be doing some eating and even giving out door prizes. So we're going to have a good time in the Lord on that day. And then also this month we've been taking up items for the White Oak Manor in Rock Kill, South Carolina. There's a list of items out there on the back on the clipboard. If you have not brought in no items for that, would you do that? That is our family service project for this month. They've been collected from the preschool. We've been collecting from the church. Wednesday night will be the last night that you can turn those items in, and then we'll kick off a brand new one for the month of March, okay? So if you hadn't done that yet, participating in that, please do that. And then we'd love to have you be a part of that. And also tomorrow night from 5 to 7, Greater Life Preschool is having an art fair here at the church. We'll be rearranging the sanctuary, getting everything ready for that. But tomorrow night from 5 to 7, I want you to come by if you can, drop in and be a part of that art fair tomorrow night. Amen? Amen. And as far as anything else, all we're going to do tonight is we're going to worship the Lord. Don't you think He's worthy? I think He's real worthy, ain't He? If God never did another thing for us, he did enough when he said, it is finished. Amen. God ripped the veil from top to bottom. Amen. We've been having ourselves a time ever since, ain't we? Amen. Well, let's worship the Lord tonight by giving of our tithe and our offering. We're going to allow our ushers to come and get in place. And we want you to give tonight as God has blessed you. And every dime that comes in always goes to further the gospel story to make a difference in somebody's life. Our children will be taking up their money walking around. We're going to have a good time in the Lord tonight. We're going to pray. And Pastor Tyler's going to come and lead us in a hymnal, The Meeting in the Air. Amen. Bow with me as we pray tonight. Father, I love you. God, I'm grateful and thankful for the stirring of your Spirit of God in our place. Lord, we're thankful tonight that we can worship you in spirit and truth. And God, worship you by giving back that a part, Lord. You only ask for a part of what you bless us with. So I pray, God, Lord, that you'll take this offering tonight. You have blessed the gift and the giver, bring the remainder of our service. God, and by everything said and done, do one thing tonight. That would be to glorify the Son of God. Feed your children tonight, God. Have your way. In Jesus' name I pray. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. You remain standing as we sing.
You have heard of little Moses in the bulrush. You have heard of fearless David and his sling. You have heard the story told of dreaming Joseph and of Jonah and the whale you often sing. There are many, many others through the Bible. I should like to meet them all, I do declare. By and by the Lord will surely let us meet them at that meeting in the air. There is going to be a meeting in the air in the sweet, sweet by and by. I am going to meet you over there in that hall beyond the sky. Such singing you will hear, never heard my mortal ear, will be glorious, I do declare. For God's own Son will be the leading one in that meeting in the air. Many things will there be missing in that meeting, for the mourner's bench will have no place at all. There will never be a sermon preached to sinners, for the sinner had refused to heed the call. There will be no mourning over wayward loved ones. There will be no lonely nights of pleading prayer. All our burdens and our anguish will be lifted at that meeting in the air. Oh, come on, sing now. There is going to be a meeting in the air in the sweet, sweet by and by. I am going to meet you over there in that hall beyond the sky. Such singing you will hear, never hurt my mortal ear. 'Twill be glorious, I do declare. For God's own Son will be the leading one in that meeting in the air. There the doubters will be missing altogether. All the skeptics will be absent on that day. There will be no grumblers present to disturb us, and the angels will be busy far away. There the saints will have his seal upon their foreheads, dressed in raiment none but ransomed ones can wear. All who have the wedding garments will be present at that meeting. One more time, sing now. There is going to be a meeting in the air in the sweet, sweet by and by. I am going to meet you over there in that hall beyond the sky. Such singing you will hear, never hurt my mortal ear. 'Twill be glorious, I do declare. And God's own Son will be the leading.
looking forward to going to that meeting. Somebody say amen right there.
There is coming a day with no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be.
Sing all together now.
And what a day that will be. With my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land.
What a day.
What a day. Glory.
There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, and no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one.
Voices, church.
And what a
day that will be.
When I
all sing, you can do better than that.
The one and when he and leave. Oh, what a day, glorious day that will be.
Amen. You can be seated all across the house. We thank God for what God's doing in our hearts and around our counties. And many of you know, Monday night, there was supposed to be a one-night revival meeting at Antioch Baptist Church in Lancaster, South Carolina, with Pastor C.T. He was there Monday night, and boy, God blew the roof off that place Monday night. And God really did a big thing in our hearts. And the pastor there, Antioch, felt led to go back Tuesday night. And C.T.'s busy, kind of a busy guy, and so Trent, the pastor Antioch, walked up to me right before church was over on Monday night and said, I think the Lord wants us to go another night. Can you preach tomorrow night? And I was kind of like, oh boy, you know what I mean? Like, if God's doing something, hear me, I'm very careful. I don't want to ever get in the way of anything God's doing. And I said, well, first, I said, I will, but first let's go ask him. And so he went up, talked to CT, and CT agreed to come back Tuesday night. Tuesday night, man, I don't know how many of you were there Tuesday night, but the Lord just greatly showed up Tuesday night and saved several people. God did a really big thing, and so the preacher was going to go on. Brother C.T. had other meetings he had to be at this week. And so starting on Wednesday night, I started preaching Wednesday night, and I preached Wednesday night. God met with us Wednesday night, and I want to tell all of you, thank you, that all of you that moved and drove down there, kind of a last-minute thing. Thank you for doing that, and coming meant the world to me. And then on Thursday night, we showed up, and the praise team started singing, and I preached about crumbs on Thursday night. And boy, I'm telling you, we got close to the master's table Thursday night, and the Lord dumped in our lap a whole bunch of crumbs. We had a good time together. Last night, Friday night, rather, we went, saw several people saved Friday night, and God is doing, I really don't want to put no certain word on it. I just want to say this, that God is moving in a unique way. And I don't ever want to get over being around the presence of God. I don't ever want to get around being around the power of God. And Preacher Trent called me this morning and said that they had some saved in their service. God was doing a big thing. And here's what's been a big deal to me is throughout this week, I mean literally me personally and other people have heard testimonies of people that were going up to each other and apologizing for things in their life they had towards each other and said, hey, I just want you to know that I'm sorry for how I've been feeling towards you. And hear me, that is revival. Revival's not where 10,000 people get saved. Revival's not where 50, no. Revival is where God's people get right with God, seek His face, and then God sends revival to our hearts. And I've seen that, and the preacher was talking about this morning, and they're going back tonight, and I don't know if they're going to have church tomorrow night or not. If they do, I'll be the one preaching. He's going to decide that tonight after their service is over. And if we do that, we'll do a call out to you all first thing in the morning, let you know what they're going to do. We really don't know that. All the preacher's doing is going service by service, step by step. But I will say this. If we do have one, if you don't get our call outs, you need to see me or the preacher tonight and sign up to get that so that way we can let you know this happened. Two, if we tell you we're having church tomorrow night, I would do everything in your power. I know some of you got the art fair, and you can come here. Those of you that are not working the art fair, everybody else can come to the art fair at 5 o'clock, do what you need to do here, and then go to Antioch or whatever. If you can't come Monday night, if we go Tuesday, whatever, here's what I'm saying. You need to do everything in your power to get around the moving of God. I've heard it best say like this, if the fire's hot enough, even wet wood will burn. And you may say, preacher, well, it's been a long time since I really felt the presence of God. Then you need to find a place where God's moving. Put yourself right smack dab in the middle of it and watch God overflow and explode inside your heart. We've been praying in this building for weeks and weeks and weeks asking God to send revival. And I'm not so narrow-minded enough to think that the only place God could send revival is at 17025 Lancaster Highway. Hear me whenever I tell you, if it's 25 minutes on down the road, I am okay with that if that's where He wants to use us in revival. And I want to be a part of what God's doing. I don't want to miss out on that. I don't want to just be watched from afar. I want to be a part of it and experience that and see all that God is doing. Here's what I want to do tonight, and we'll open it up a little bit later. But I would love, Miss Miranda, I'd love for you to just stand up. And whatever it is on your heart, maybe she texted me yesterday and told me that the Lord had put something on her heart from that she was at revival, I guess, every night, except for maybe Monday night. I don't know if y'all were there Monday night, but you were there every other night, I think, or whenever. But I want you to just stand up and just tell what's on your heart. Just brag on Jesus. Thank you.
for your blessings on me. Now I know that I'm not wealthy, and these clothes, they're not new. I don't have much money, but Lord, I have you into me. You're all that matters, though the world may not see. So we say thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Cause there's a roof up above me. I've a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. So we say thank you. For your blessings on me.
Well, grab your Bibles. Go with me to the book of Genesis. Let's go back to the very beginning where it all started. Genesis chapter number 2. Genesis chapter number 2. Stand with me all over the building tonight as we read and give reverence to God's word. I'd ask you to help me preach tonight. I don't want to preach by myself. I don't want you to leave me hanging out by myself. I'll need you to help me, all right? Genesis chapter number 2, verse number 18. If you're there and you love Jesus, say amen. And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I say amen to that. Hear me whenever I tell you this, being by yourself is a bad place to be. You hear me? It's not a good place to be alone. You say, preacher, well, I'm not married. Well, you need to find you some good friends you can be with. It's not a good place to be alone. The devil's biggest playground is a Christian by their self. I will make for him. I will make him and help meet for him. Verse number 19 says, and out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air and brought them unto Adam, to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. Verse number 20. And Adam gave names to all cattle, and to the fowl of the air, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found an help meet for him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam. And he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib, which the Lord God had taken from man, made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And God said, this is now bone, or and Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore, take note here, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. I'd love to talk to you, preach to you, submit to you tonight this thought, living the wondrous woman, living as the wondrous woman. Let's pray tonight. God, in Jesus' name, I ask you to help me tonight. Truth be told, Lord, I'm fixing to do something I've never done before. I'm fixing to preach on a topic I've never preached on before. Lord, I need your help tonight. I don't want the people to hear me. I need them to hear you tonight. Lord, tonight it is not my intentions to use some book or to use some writer or to use some philosophy of man. I'm strictly, Lord, on purpose going to use your Bible tonight as our map, as our guide to show us how to be a wondrous woman in 2023. We need that tonight. Holy Ghost, we need your help tonight. I pray you'd speak to us tonight. I pray you'd move inside this building and begin to stir the hearts of man, Lord. Begin to stir the hearts of the ladies, God. Do something spectacular in our hearts tonight, and may we feel your presence tonight. In Jesus' name I pray. And all God's people said, you may be seated. Thank you for sitting. The wondrous woman. Can I really quickly just speak for every man in the house and say this? I thank God he made a woman. For all y'all men that didn't say amen, we'll have a talk with you later. Somebody say amen right there. I thank God that he made a woman. How many of you know that I wouldn't have iron clothes if he wouldn't have made a woman? Somebody say amen right there. I wouldn't eat good if he didn't. Come on, somebody. You know what I mean? I thank God he made a woman. God, now watch me here. God has a direct plan on how to be successful, how to be happy as a lady. And let's just be honest tonight. No one, and I mean no one, likes being around a bitter, mean, angry, hateful woman. Can I say this? Some of the meanest people in the whole wide world can be a woman in a bad mood. Now, y'all can all act like you ain't. You ain't going to shout me if you don't want to. I'm fine with that. I ain't scared of your wife like my wife, like you're scared of your wife, all right? Let's be very clear here. Understand, you want to just have a bad day, tick your wife off. You want to have a real bad evening, make your wife mad. Yeah. Hear me. And no one likes being around a bitter person or a mean person, and that goes both ways. And sure, you say, well, preacher, you should see the way he treats me, or you should see who I have to live with, or you should see how if your kids act the way my kids act, you'd be mad. And sure, we could all contribute to that. But I will say a lot of times you find a woman who isn't happy or satisfied. You can trace it back and find a woman who isn't following the direct orders of why God has a woman on this earth in the first place. A lot of women, let's understand, a lot of women who would rather live in misery claiming that they are chasing God's will. But I will say I have never seen a miserable person in the center of the will of God. Can I say this right here? And I believe I can preach to every single person, man and woman alike in this building. The best place in the whole world, in the whole wide world to be, is right in the center of the will of God. I'd rather be in the center of the will of God than anywhere else that I know. If I was a teenager, if I was a young adult, if I was a single, if I was a husband, if I was a wife, if I was a man, if I was a wife, it wouldn't make no difference. There is something. Listen to me. God has a purpose for you. God has a plan for you. God has a direct. God didn't just save you to take you to heaven, but God has a will for your life. And the best place anybody can be is right in the center of the will of God. I believe this with every fiber of my being. God has a blueprint on how to be a wondrous woman. And let's be very clear here, and we got to understand this, that tonight, in order to dissect the Word of God and go through this, we've got to all agree that we're not trying to find the latest book on how to be a successful woman. We're not looking for the most trending video on TikTok or on Instagram on how to be a successful mom or a lady or a wife. No. We've got to understand that the Word of God has the exact blueprint on how to be a successful, happy, wondrous woman. Hear me. I didn't come here tonight to tell you to go buy this book or subscribe to this page. I come to tell you this. The Word of God, listen to me, it's not outdated. It's not old-fashioned. It's not old-timey. It still stands true. And I know in 2020, you better listen to me, in 2023, there are people out there
There are pages out there. There are philosophers out there. There are all these people out there that will tell you, you need to do this and you need to do that. And I come to tell you the only way, you better hear me, the only way you can be successful and happy with joy in your heart, with a pep in your step, with a shout in your lung, woman, in 2023 is to walk and to talk and to breathe the Word of God. Can I go ahead and speak this? Some of y'all, what some of y'all need to do, especially younger generation, what you need to do is delete Instagram, delete TikTok, delete Facebook, stop following all those influencers that all they put is perfect things on it, and you need to dive into the Word of God, follow after the Word of God, and it'll change your entire life. I'm just here to tell you the Word of God. I believe this every. I'm so sick and tired of hearing people say the Bible's outdated. I'm so sick and tired of hearing people say, well, you got to read after this author and read after that. I've just chose. You can call me old-fashioned. You can call me crazy, but I have just chose that God is the only author that we need. God has the answers. God, you listen to me. You got kid problems. God has the answer. You got financial problems. God has the answer. You got trouble in your life. God, the B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that is the book for me. Thy Word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against God. I'm trying to tell you tonight, understand me, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Understand me tonight, our world is dark, our world is wicked, our world is disgusting, our world is nasty and is full of sin-filled people running across this world. But I come to speak life into every single one of you ladies inside this church. If you're 5, if you're 10, if you're 35 or 105, it ought to be your desire and it ought to be your passion. And it ought to be your heart to walk in the middle of this wicked, hell-filled society and be a woman filled with the Word of God. Be a woman on top of the Word of God, walking with Jesus, talking. I'm sick and tired of hearing people say, well, you can't be happy and serve Jesus. You can't be happy. No, no, no. I come to tell you, God has the best life. God has the best life. The Word of God has the best life. God, help us to get grounded in the Word of God and follow after what He has to tell us. I'm here to submit to you that God's way still works. I don't care what the latest influencers say, God's way still works. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 4 says, a virtuous woman is a crown to her husband, but she that taketh ashamed is as rottenness in his bones. Proverbs 31:10 says, who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. What do these verses tell us tonight? Here's what it tells us, that you can't put a price tag on a virtuous woman. Can I say this to all you men? If you've got a good Bible-believing, good Christian woman, you ought to take great pride in that. You ought to thank God for her every... Hear me. Some of y'all didn't have nothing to shout for a minute ago or testify. Some of y'all should have stand up. I thank God. God gave me a good wife. I thank God. God gave me a woman that loves the Word of God, that walks and talks and breathes. Hear me. And God help us understand that you cannot put a price tag on a woman who breathes and lives the Word of God. Proverbs tells us, what does it tell us? It tells us that you cannot put a price tag, but it also tells us this, that it's hard to find a virtuous woman. Can I say this tonight? No wonder there are so many young Christian men walking around single by themselves. Can I tell you why? Because it's hard to find in 2023 a good Bible-believing woman who walks with God, who talks with God, who has bruises on her kneecaps because she stays on her knees getting a hold of God for her children, for her family. Hear me whenever I tell you. And what our churches need, can I tell you what our churches need, what America needs, what our society needs? It needs some ladies that would get slap full of the Holy Ghost, that would get around the Word of God, that would walk and read and be engulfed in the Word of God and make up their mind for my children's sake, for my home's sake, for my family's sake, for my church's sake, for my society's sake. I want to be a woman that walks by the Word of God. I want to be a woman that when people see me, they don't see me as a good mama. They don't see me as a good dad. They don't see me as a good wife. They don't see me as a good grandma. No, no. I don't need to be seen as a good grandma who spoils my kids on Christmas. I don't need to be seen as a good wife who rubs my husband's feet when he gets off work. I don't need to be seen as a good mom who always fixes my kids' supper. I want to be seen as a mama who loves Jesus. I want to be seen as a grandma who loves Jesus. I want to be seen as a wife who loves Jesus and who serves the Lord in this generation today. I'm here to tell you tonight what would change our entire world is if people would understand that God's way still works. God help, and can I say this tonight to Greater Life? God help the ladies of this church.
no matter how old you are, to make up your mind in a world full of sinful, dirty, disobedient people to live with your mind made up, I'd rather be right with God than anything that I know. I'd rather have Jesus than anything I know. Some of y'all, listen to me, some of y'all, the reason your marriage is in such a mess is because you're trying to be right with your husband instead of being right with God. The reason your children are so rebellious is because you're trying to be right with your children instead of being right with God. The reason you're so miserable is because you're trying to be right with everybody else instead of, can I tell you what happened, what's so wonderful about God? If you're right with Him, everything else will fall in line. Understanding, I want to give you a few things according to the Word of God tonight. I promise you, I will try not to be long. That will instruct you on how to be a wondrous woman. Number one tonight, I would love to say, in order to be a wondrous woman, you've got to be able to submit to authority. That's all right. I didn't expect y'all to say amen right there. I was already prepared for this. Go to Ephesians, Nate, if you would, please. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22. Says this, wives, how many are wives tonight? Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. Next verse, Nate. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and He is the Savior of the body. Somebody ought to say amen right there. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Now, I'm fixing to talk to y'all about some things that have been completely omitted in the average household in 2023. But just because it's hard to talk about, and just because it's hard to preach about, and just because you don't say amen like you said amen a minute ago, doesn't change that it's still the Word of God, and God's Word is still final. Colossians chapter number 3, verse number 18, what's it say? Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as it is fit in the Lord. I am fully aware that in our generation, these verses have been omitted out of the average home, and we've tried to blame it on everything. Watch me. We try to blame it on character. Well, I was born this way. I was born with a non-submissive spirit. I was born ready to lead. We try to blame it on how we were born. We try to blame it on character. We try to blame it on past relate. Well, I was mistreated when I was a child. Well, my previous marriage, my husband took advantage of me. We try to blame it on our past relationships. We try to blame it on how we were born. We try to blame it on character or whatever other excuse you want to give. However, I am here tonight to submit to you that this is one of the biggest tools the devil is using to destroy every woman inside this room. If he can get you to go opposite of the Word of God and away from the Word of God and the opposite direction of the Word of God, he will get inside your marriage. He will get inside your life. Hear me now. I'm trying to tell you, we'll make up our mind. It ain't popular preaching, and I'm all right with that. I signed up for this whenever I tell you that God's Word is still final. God's Word does still stand true. God put a structure together, and it ain't up to us to decide if we believe it or if we don't believe it. I used to hear a preacher say, well, if God said it and I believe it, that settles it. Can I tell you, it really don't make a rip if you believe it or not, honey. If God said it, then that settles it. Hear me whenever I tell you, the Word of God was very direct, giving us specific instructions to do this, to submit to your husband. And whenever that is not done, I wish you'd hear me. The Word of God didn't cut any corners whenever He said, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands, unless you have a strong character trait, unless you're the boss at your job, unless you had a previous past mess of a relationship. No. He said, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as it is fit in the Lord. The Word of God was very direct in what He said. And understand this tonight, whenever we do not operate by the Word of God, every lady in this room, zero in on this, there is no way, if you're not submitting to the authority in your life, that you are in the will of God. Hear me? I need every lady to hear me there right now and understand this. If you are not, I don't care what excuse you want to give, if you do not submit to your husband, you are out of the will of God. I believe with every fiber in my being, God has put together a structure. God has put together, and by the way, I don't know if you know this or not, but he didn't ask your opinion when he wrote the Bible. He didn't ask my opinion when he wrote, no, God was very direct, and he knew exactly how this thing was going to set up, and he didn't care what you thought about it whenever he said, this is how it is supposed to be. Listen to me, what happens when someone in the marriage gets out of the will of God, can I tell you, it drags both of them down. Can we be very clear here? We can go to Genesis chapter 3 and find out the only reason we're in this mess to begin with is because the roles were swapped in the marriage. The woman started making a decision, and the man wasn't man enough to stand up and be the man of the house. And because of that, sin and Satan entered into the home today. Watch me here. It's very important that we understand. Listen, can I tell you what the enemy hates today? The enemy hates a godly woman. The enemy hates a godly home. Why do you think we're preaching on family? Because we understand this. If the family is structured right, the church will explode. If the family operates right, the church will explode. If the family operates right, the school systems will be changed. If the family operates right, the economy, everything in our world will change if God's people, the family of God, would get back to operating by the word of God. That word submit in the Greek, which is in the New Testament, where speaking of the Greek, simply means this, to obey. Or to be under subjection. It's the exact same word used in James chapter 4, verse number 7, when the Bible says, submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Go with me here. Let me try to help you here. I'm sorry to tell you ladies this. Listen to me. But you are not on the same level as your husband. But preacher, The vlog that I viewed yesterday said that we were equal. But I come to tell you the word of God says you're not. Go with me here. I didn't write the book. God did. However, we must understand this. Just because you're not on, listen to me, ladies, understand, and all you men hear me right here too. Just because you're not on the same level as each other, just because you're not on the same level as your husband does not mean you get treated like a slave or a doormat. Would we all agree that God is the highest authority? Here's how the structure works in a home. It is God, it is man, it is woman. And we could all agree that the woman is under the man. But understand me, just because we're under God, God ain't never made any of us feel like we're second class. God ain't never made any of us feel like we're unworthy, or he don't treat it. No, he don't treat us like. Can I be honest? Can we be very clear? God makes us feel like we're the most special person in the whole wide world. God makes us feel like we're his only child. God makes us feel like that he loves it. Can I be honest? I believe God loves me more than anybody else, because that's how he treats me. He acts like he loves me. He hears my prayers. He comes to where I am. He goes to him, and God treats it. But can I tell you, the same goes for every man inside this place. If you got a godly woman, a woman that loves God, that serves God, you want to treat her like she's the most precious thing in the whole wide world. You want to treat her like she lets you love her. You give anything you could for her. Just as God treats the man, so should the man treat the wife. But just as we're to submit to God, you better hear me, just as we're to submit to God, so is the wives to submit to the husbands. And it is the devil's biggest tool inside of America today to reverse the tide of the home. Because if he can reverse the tide in the home, he'll get everything out of whack from the very beginning, and it won't matter what happens after that. What could God do? My God, what could God do if some teenagers inside this room make up their mind, I want to be submissive to the authority in my life? Can we be very clear here? It is hard to be submissive to authority in your life. I'm not here saying that it's easy. Hear me, whenever I tell you all this, I hate submitting to that little white sign that says 45 on the side of the road. Come on, somebody, you know what I mean? Ain't nobody got time to go 45 miles an hour. You with me right there? No. But it doesn't change the fact that the word of God was very direct in what he gave us. He didn't ask Tyler how fast. No. He was very direct that as long as it's right with God, we are to obey the laws of the land. Do it. And hear me whenever I tell you, it doesn't change. God don't give a rip if I'm in a hurry. God don't care if I'm busy. You know what God say? Leave earlier. Get out of bed on time. Here's what I'm trying to tell you. God help us as the people of God to learn to be submissive to the authority in our life. Can I go ahead and say this to all you teenagers here? God has placed you under the authority of your mom and dad. God has put you in a place where you are
start to obey and to listen to the mom and dad. And I don't care if you're 35 years old. If you still live at home, you are under their authority per the word. And there ain't no such thing as, well, I'm 18 now. No, you won't find that in the Bible. There ain't no 18, well, I'm of 8. No. If you still live under mom and daddy's roof, you are still submit to their authority and obey what they say. God, I wish I had some help inside this room tonight. God, help us to make up our mind no matter where we are. And can I go ahead and preach to all you men? God, help all of us to be submissive to the will of God and to obey the word of God and to walk in the will of God. And what could God do if man will be submissive to God and a woman will be submissive to her husband and children will be submissive to mama and daddy? My God, we'd see revival sweep across this nation. That would shake the foundations of the world. It would change our school system. It would change our government system. It would change our church system. But it will not start until God's people get the structure right in our world today. Hear me whenever I tell you this. I don't have time tonight to tell you all the stories in just my lifetime of the men who had great potential and God could have used greatly, but were ruined because of a woman out of her role. I wish you'd hear me, ladies. You have great power. You have a way with words and other things. At least Graham gets me. The rest of y'all, I guess, you know, whatever. But it don't take much, and you could convince your man to do just about probably whatever you wanted him to do. And truth of the matter is this, if you're not careful, you'll get out of your role very quickly and ruin everything that God has in store for what God wants to do with your family because of a feeling of emotion that you're in that time. In my mind right now, I could take you to some preachers who God could have used greatly, who God, I believe, had his hand on, but now they're not even in church today. Not even in ministry. I can tell you right now of a young couple who the young man God was using greatly and was talking with me and said, "Preacher, I would love to be in ministry. I want to be in full-time. I believe God's calling me into evangelism, and this is happening, that's happening. I want to be in full-time ministry." And I said, I'd love to help you. Let's go. Follow me. I'll do everything I can to breathe on that and to help that. And now today they're not even in church, all because of a woman who got out of her role and was not submissive to the will of God. Can I say this tonight? Could it be the reason you're so miserable in your life is because you've got the first priority as a woman messed up? I'm trying not to get ahead of myself, but I wish you'd hear me. You won't find one verse in the Bible where it says for the woman to go financially support the home. Go, y'all can get quiet on me. It's all right. I'm used to preaching in dead churches anyway. Y'all don't bother me. Watch me. You won't find one verse in the Bible where it says it's the woman's job to work an 8-to-5 job. I'm not preaching against that. I'm just saying this. The Bible is very direct that a woman is to submit to her husband and follow after her husband and lead. And I dare say the reason why a lot of men have a hard time leading is because a lot of women have a hard time following. But can I say this? Can I say this for all y'all strong-willed character people inside this room that you use as an excuse? You don't have a hard time submitting to your husband. You have a hard time submitting to God. Because if you'd submit right to him, I feel the Lord. I'm right where I need to be. If you'd submit to him, you'd have no problem submitting to the man God's put in your life. Either he's the man of your life or he's not. You need to make up your either he's the one God sent you or either he's the apple of your eye. But if he is, and if he is the one God sent you, and if he is the one God made for you, and if he is the one God handpicked for you, it is your duty, it is your obligation, according to the word of God, to say wherever you want me to go, whatever you want me to do, that is what I'm willing to do. Because I am trusting that you are the one as unto the Lord. If you're walking with Jesus, if you're talking with Jesus, I'll follow you. I'll be there with you. I'll help you. I'll nurture. I'll do whatever I can to submit to the authority that God has placed inside of my life. Somebody ought to say amen right there. In order to be a wondrous woman, you have to submit. Here's what I believe. I believe we have a hard time doing things like this because we view it as a personal matter. But I hate to tell you this, but
your husband didn't write the Bible. Believe it or not, watch me here. Believe it or not, your husband didn't decide to be the husband. God made him that. You didn't decide if he was going to be a wife or a man, or a husband or a wife, or a wife or a wife or a husband or a lady or a man. No, no. God made you that way. God didn't ask us what we want to be. God, so if God, if the Almighty, omnipotent, wonderful God sees you and made, the Bible says he formed man out of the dust of the ground, breathed into the nostrils of man, so the man became a living. If God can do that, and then God can supernaturally cut open the side of Adam, reach in and grab a rib and form Eve and make Eve who she, if God can do all that, surely he has the blueprint in how to be a happy man and a happy woman and a successful home and be successful parents. And I made up, y'all better hear me, I made up my mind. This world is too, listen to me, this world that this time we have here on this earth is too short. I don't have that much longer to be a husband. I don't have that much longer to be a wife. You don't have that much longer to be a parent. So we ought to make up our mind that while God has given us this short time here on this life, I don't want to waste it. I don't want to ignore it. I don't want to walk away from it. I want to do everything in my power to be in the center of the will of God. Learning to be submissive to the will of God. Learning to be submissive to the will of God. Can I say this? Can I say this tonight without you getting upset at me? God is not going to tell you ladies the direction of your home. He's going to tell the men the direction of your home. God is not going to give you what church you need to go to. He's going to give your husband the church they need to go to. All this not, well, the Lord spoke to me. No, he didn't. No. He spoke to your husband because that is the structure of the Word of God. There, nowhere in the Bible do you find that God spoke to the woman. No. God spoke to the husband and he really, now listen to me. Now understand this. Go very carefully with me here. If the husband is right with God and if the woman is right with God and they two, which by the way, the Bible said, how can two walk together unless they agree? If they two agree and are walking together and serving God at the same time while God is speaking to the husband, he'll be on the other side speaking to the wife. And it will be walking together, agreeing in the Word of God. But let me go ahead and say this. Understand me, there are going to be times where God's going to tell the man what to do and you ain't going to agree with it. There are going to be times where God's going to tell the man what to do and you ain't going to want to do it. But you better hear me. If you want to obey the Word of God, you know what you'll do? You'll do it anyways. Because if it all falls apart, listen to me, if it all falls apart, it won't be on your shoulders, it'll be on his. But if you disobey and go opposite of what your husband says, you better listen to me, all of a sudden you have now took on the responsibility, and now you will be the one that gives account to God, and what happens, all because you were not willing to be obedient to the Word of God. To be submissive. How to be a wondrous woman, number two, I'll get off of that one so the rest of y'all can start shouting me now because you ain't mad at me no more, all right? How to be a wondrous woman, not only do you have to be submissive, but you've also got to set a standard if you're going to be a wondrous woman. Nate, bring that verse up for me in Titus, if you would, please. Titus chapter 2, verse number 3. Watch what he said. The aged women. How many are aged women? You said it, not me, all right? The aged women likewise. That they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. Verse number 4, that this is important, that they may teach the young women to be sober. Watch this. To love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, watch this, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. It is your job, it is your duty as a woman of the word of God, as a student of the word of God, to set a standard to the generation coming up behind us on what a godly, biblical woman looks like. It's not up for debate. It's not up for question. You either walk, hear me whenever I tell you, there's no gray area in the will of God. You're either in the will of God or you're not. You're either obedient to the word of God or you're disobedient to the word of God. There is no gray area here. And understand me, you must understand that there is a generation that is watching you. The woman that you are, the wife that you are, the mother that you are is setting a standard to those around you on what a godly woman is. You claim to be a Christian, so why shouldn't they take your lifestyle as what a godly woman is? And I have to submit to you tonight, ladies and gentlemen, if all you're worried about is your job, your career, your ministry, what do you think your children are going to do when they become of age? God has called up you, ladies, to rise above the latest fad, the latest popular trends, or the biggest influencers, and be the woman of the Word of God that God has called you to be. You say, preacher, are you saying it's wrong that I work? You saying it's wrong that I serve? No, I never said that. Those words never came out of my mouth. However, I would love to submit to you tonight, and I will say that your first ministry and your first requirement, as the Word of God tells us, is to your husband, it is to your kids, and it is to your home. And if those are lacking tonight, ladies and gentlemen, then yes, your job is wrong, your ministry is wrong, your sermon is wrong, because there is no way, you've been listening to me, there is no way steps 3, 4, 5, and 6 can be right if steps 1 and 2 are wrong. I'm not saying you cannot work, but I am saying this. Maybe could it be your priorities are slap out of whack, your timing is out of whack, where you're walking. Hear me whenever I tell you, God, help us as a people of God to understand there is a generation out there that would love to have you. Hear me, there's a generation out there that would love to have your children and to tear apart your children and to tear apart this generation. There's some people out there that would love to have your marriage, love to have your man, love to have your husband, and it would do them joy to rip your marriage apart if you'd be another statistic of a cheating husband or a divorced home. God help us to understand. Sure, we may have a nice car because we both work jobs. Sure, we may have a big house because we both work jobs. But I've got to ask you, who's raising your children, mama? Who's loving your husband, mama? Somebody ought to make up their mind. My first responsibility, my first duty is to be with my husband and to love on my babies. Because it'll be over my dead body for the devil gets my babies, for the devil gets my children. At what cost would a nice house be? Would a nice home be? God help us today to love over those babies and to love over those husbands and to say it'll be my marriage. I will stand tall. I will guard the gate. I won't let sex in. I won't let drugs in. I won't let pornography in. I won't let the outside influences get in. I will stand guard. I will protect from my enemy. I will protect what God's given me. I will set the standard of what the Word of God says for me to do. You say, preacher, you saying I should quit my job? I didn't say that. The Holy Ghost may have, but I didn't say that. I'm just saying this. Somebody is raising your babies. And if you ain't, who is? Somebody is going to love your husband. And if you ain't, who is? You better listen to me. I'm telling you. I don't care what you think about your man. All marriages are subject to falling. There ain't a bulletproof marriage in this building. And if the devil, listen to me, the devil don't attack the church, he attacks the family. And if we're going to preach to the men and tell the men they better start stand guard and protect from the outsiders getting in, we also got to preach to the women and tell the women you better protect what God's called you to do too, and stay in your role and follow after your man. Be there with your husband. I refuse to go to church by myself. I want my wife to be there with me. Why? Because I don't trust my flesh. I know I'm subject to fall. So if she can walk with me, if she can stand with me, how can two walk together unless they agree? And we agree together. The devil will not get our babies. He will not get our church. He will not get our ministry. He will not get our marriage. We're going to stand guard and set a standard. This is the way the Word of God said. So that's what we're going to do. God, help us. Hear me. I don't care what the latest thing says on TikTok or Instagram. God, help us to get to the Word of God. Set a standard that this is what I'm supposed to do. Say, preacher, how do I know if I'm operating right? I've got to ask you. How much time do you spend on your job? How much time do you spend in your ministry? How much time do you spend in your hobby? And then how much time do you spend with your husband? How much time do you spend with your children? How much time do you spend in the Word of God? Can I help you here? If those things are messed up, then something's not right in the home. Well, preacher, you don't understand. We can't live off of just one income. All right? Sure. Maybe you will have a nice house. Maybe you will have a nice car. Maybe you will be debt-free. But what's it going to cost you? Somebody's going to pay the price. And you want to know why America's in the shape it's in? You want to know why we've got kids in the school system going to school dressed like cats and using the bathroom in a litter box in Indianland High School? Can I tell you why? Because mama's role's messed up at the house. You ain't got to agree with me. It don't matter to me. I know the word of God. I know it to be true. And what could God do with some mamas and some women that make up their mind, I will trade anything in this world I've got to trade as long as I can protect what God's given me at the house and set a standard that this is the way it's supposed to be. I will guard the gate. Set a standard, Mom. You can come play something on that piano. I'm nearly done right here. I just believe this. I believe when you get a room full of women together that are in the will of God, that are walking together, that are agreeing together, and that are living together, there's no telling what God could do. Can I say this tonight? For all of you in here that may think you're too old for this to apply to, well, I'm not a wife, not a mother anymore. I'm just kind of in this age of my life. I really don't know what to do, but can I help you here and tell you this? You're still setting a standard. There's a generation coming up behind you that are watching everything you do. Can I preach to the older generation for just a moment who you think you're too washed up to be used of God? Can I tell you, my generation, my little babies need a grandma who still knows how to worship. My generation needs a grandma who sit at the entrance tent of Pumpkin Patch every single day, and all you do is smile, but my babies sure know that you're there. You say, preacher, well, nobody notices me. No. The Lord notices you, and he's required you to set a standard. Listen to me. If you don't serve the Lord, who's going to? If you don't worship the Lord, who's going to? They tell me statistics say that our children will be half the Christian that we are. And that burdens my heart to think that my children's spirituality is going to depend on how mama and daddy live their life. Setting a standard. I have absolutely been privileged to what I would consider the greatest woman in the whole wide world, with Michaela as my wife. God has supernaturally made us for each other. We practically grew up together. And I have not a doubt in my mind, God made her for me. God made me for her. I know this to be true. Couldn't nobody else put up with me the way she puts up with me? Whenever I said I wouldn't be wearing iron clothes if it wasn't for Michaela, I meant that unless Michaela couldn't do it and I brought it to the office and let my mom do it. Somebody say amen right there. Either way, God has blessed me with a woman who knows her Bible and would follow me to hell if that's where I said the Lord wanted us to go. Would follow me wherever it is because she understands this, that the Word of God said it, and that settles it. But not only does she submit, but my favorite part about Michaela is she sets a standard. A standard that, listen to me very carefully, if my daughters are half the woman that she is, they'll be all right. I believe that. Setting a standard goes much deeper than just being a wife. But can I tell you something? Somebody need to set a standard when it comes to modesty. Yeah. You ought to set a standard when it comes to modesty. You ought to dress right. You ought to look right. I still believe in dressing right, looking right. I still believe in looking right when you come to the house of God, walking and listen to me. Don't tell me you're a Christian if you ain't willing to dress like a Christian. I still believe you ought to set a standard when it comes to modesty. I believe this. I believe you ought to set a standard when it comes to worship. Yeah. Don't tell your babies you love Jesus if you ain't willing to worship Jesus too. Yeah. Yeah. Hear me. I've got two little girls and a little boy at home. Cooper is just now starting to kind of put words together, read a little bit. And all thanks to his mom, because Lord knows if I try to teach him how to read, he'd be reading backwards. Somebody say amen right there. And before my kids can ever read a Bible, they're watching mama. Before they can ever read a Bible, they're watching daddy. And I watch as little Ella Kate, she ain't but 2 years old. She's got about 25 and a half baby dolls at the house. And she'll walk around, and all she'll do is she'll hold the baby and she'll just pat their back. She walked in a room last night and she said, "Daddy, I need to change her diaper." And I said, "Yeah, you need to do that, not me." All the men say amen right there. Yeah. But I say all that to say this. She knows how to treat a baby because she's watched mama. She ain't looked up no video on how to be a mama. She ain't read no book on how to be a good mama. She ain't read no Bible. She ain't even listened to no preacher on how to be a good submissive, set and standard. No. All she's done is she's watched mama. I watch as little Ella Kate walk through the house, even Cooper walk through the house, and she'll start singing just random songs, not worldly songs, but Christian songs. Because if you know anything about Michaela, you know that all the time, she's singing. And little Ella Kate will be walking through the house, and she'll just, "Daddy, sing Jesus Loves Me with me." And that does something for my heart, because she could be wanting to sing anything in the whole wide world, but she wants to sing Jesus Loves Me. And I have to tell you, the reason those things are is because mama sets a standard. Sets a standard. And you ought to hear me. I've made up my mind. You can have the popularity. You can have the latest trends. You can have the best videos. You can put on all the fronts you want to the church and make it look like you got the perfect marriage and the perfect home. I don't care what you can have all that mess. I've made up my mind. What we've got at home is greater than anything money can buy, than anything popularity can buy, because God has put us together and given me a woman that'll set a standard, that I can believe and know that if my babies will be like mama, everything will be okay. I'll watch them as they'll lift up their hand during worship. Truth of the matter is this, y'all. Most of the time we're in church, 9 out of 10 times we're in church, daddy's on the stage. If we're here or if we're gone, daddy's on the stage. I don't get to worship my family very often. And so to see them lifting up their hands towards heaven, that tells me they've been watching mama lift up her hand towards heaven. And that may not do much for some of y'all, but I'm trying to tell you, it works. Mamas, it works. Wives, it works. Ladies, it works. To be a woman after God, to walk with God, to live for God, and to set a standard of this is the way it's supposed to be. Can I tell you, listen to me, there's nothing wrong with being right according to the Word of God. There's nothing wrong with it. I wonder how many of you ladies would just find a place around the altar. If you've got a husband with you, some of you ought to come. You ought to go with your wife, find a place around this altar. Some of you teenagers ought to find a place around this altar. Some of you girls, some of you single girls ought to find a place around this altar. And here's a good prayer tonight. Lord, help me be a biblical woman. Maybe some of you aren't very good at the whole submissive thing. You ought to come pray and ask the Lord to help you with that. Maybe some of you aren't very good at the whole setting a standard thing. You ought to come pray and ask the Lord to help you with that, because we want to be right with God. We want to be what God wants us to be. We want to be a generation and a lady. We want to be a church filled with ladies that are following and obedient to the Word of God. Holy Ghost, I've done my part tonight. Now, God, tonight I ask you that you take this. I pray you speak to every lady in this room. I thank you for the women of Greater Life Baptist Church. I'm fully aware that if it wasn't for the ladies of this church, there's a whole lot of things that would never get accomplished. And I thank you for them. But God, help us to understand we've never arrived anywhere. There's always room for more. There's always room for better. And God, help us to achieve that next level. God, can I go ahead and speak this for some of the ladies that's in this room that don't have a godly husband to follow, that don't have a godly man to lead, to follow after? God, I pray you get a hold of those men. I pray you save those men. I pray you use a godly, submissive, setting a standard wife to set a standard of what it's like to be a Christian in front of their husband. And God, do that for the glory of God. We love you tonight. We thank you tonight for all that you're doing. In Jesus' name I pray. And all God's people said, amen. Another lady in this church that by all means sets a standard is Miss Phyllis. She serves, she worships, she prays, she's faithful, she sings, sets a standard. On Tuesday, Miss Phyllis is going to go in to have an operation. And I would like, if you all would help me, together around Miss Phyllis tonight, and let's pray over her. Let's pray for her. Maybe some of you ladies come first, and the men will gather around them. Let's pray God's hand of protection around the doctors, God's hand of protection around the situation. Our pastor is going to lead us in prayer. We're going to pray for this household, that God would give the doctors wisdom, knowledge, and that she would know she got a family that loves her, a church family that loves her, that supports her, that's there for her. May we pray together.
Our Father, we bow our heads before you right now, God. And Lord, we come to you this evening, God, Lord, first of all, thanking you, Lord, for being a God that loves us and takes care of us and understands what we are and who we are. And God, right now, Lord, we bring Miss Phyllis before you, Lord, asking you, God, that you would be with her. God, Lord, for months now, she's been dealing with some elements, some things in her body, and God, Lord, this coming Tuesday, Lord, the 28th. God, Lord, you're going to do something supernatural. And God, we're trusting you this Tuesday, God, that you're going to be with her as she goes in to that surgery room, God. And I pray, Lord, for the physicians. God, I pray, Lord, for the nurses and all those that's going to surround her. I pray, God, that you would guide their hands. God, I pray, God, Lord, that you would do through them, Lord, that would bring glory and honor to your name, God. We lift her up, God. We appreciate who she is. God, I appreciate her testimony. God, Lord, I've known her for a few years now. I've sat in her home. I've watched her love her husband, follow her husband, submit to her husband, God. I've watched her worship you in church. I've watched her serve you around the campus, God, and do things, God, Lord, to be a mother and to be a grandmother. And God, Lord, she's always giving you the glory and the honor. So, God, Lord, we're coming to you right now and asking you, God, that you would touch Miss Phyllis. I pray, God, Lord, that you would comfort her. God, Lord, be with her in her mind, God. No doubt she's worried for some time now. And, God, Lord, she's going to be nervous going to the operating room on Tuesday. I pray, God, Lord, that you would calm her nerves. You remind her, God, Lord, that she may be under a literal physical physician, but you are the great physician, God, and you are in control of everything that's transpiring and happening, God. And I pray, God, Lord, for a successful surgery. I pray, God, Lord, for a quick recovery. God, I thank you, Lord, for the man that you brought to her in her life. I pray you, Lord, for this couple, Lord, the example they set before the rest of us, Lord, of being married all these years, God. And I'm thankful, Lord, for the man of God that you've given her, for Brother Fred, God. I pray, God, Lord, for him, Lord. Lord, on Tuesday, Lord, when they're doing this operation, you would also comfort him, remind him, Lord, that Miss Phyllis is in your hands. And together in agreement tonight, God, your people, God, at Greater Life, Lord, we are agreeing together that your will is going to be done. And God, I pray. pray, God, you'd be with her, watch over, protect her. And, God, Lord, in days to come, we will hear the great report of how good you've been to Miss Phyllis. Your hand has been upon her. You've helped her, God, and you've delivered her from this thing that's going on with her. Have your way, God, and we're going to thank you for all that's accomplished. It's your name we pray, and the church house says, amen and amen.